Good morning, good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us for what is a rather historic event today at the AA. And I use the word historic in two senses. Firstly, by inviting Abe Rogers to speak to us today, we make fond reference to Abe's father, Richard Rogers' time as a student at the AA in the 1950s. And we also very much celebrate Abe's legacy as a designer, as well as his passionate advocacy for changing how we think about design and architecture in relation to neurodiversity. As far as I can tell, nobody has addressed the school on this topic, especially as a designer. So we thank Abe most warmly for the honor of having him here with us today. So allow me to introduce Abe to you in a moment. But firstly, I would like to just put things into perspective for us for a moment. Apparently 5 to 10% of the general population, worldwide population actually, identify as having dyslexia. However, when you examine certain concentrated groups, or when you examine the figures in these certain concentrated groups, groups such as the AA, these numbers can jump to anything as much as 25% or more. Our hope today is not simply to increase awareness and reduce stigmas surrounding learning difficulties, but really to go further than this by exploring how design and architecture are really enhanced by the incredibly innovative and I would say humanitarian ways of seeing the world through a neurodiverse lens. On this note, let me tell you a little bit more about Abe Rogers. Abe is a London-based designer who spent 30 years perfecting his dyslexia. Known for a wide-ranging practice informed by a lyrical imagination, Abe founded Abe Rogers Design, ARD, in 2004 and established a studio unafraid to play with color, materials, and function in order to inject a sense of poetry, magic, and wonder into the everyday world. ARD's past clients include the Pompidou Centre, Tate Modern, Royal Academy, Science Museum, the Australian Centre for Moving Image, Maggie's, Selfridges, Condé Nast, Wonderfruit, Price Cooper, PricewaterhouseCooper, and Scape Living, for whom ARD have designed student housing schemes at Mile End, Shoreditch, Guildford, and Melbourne. New sites are planned for Brisbane, Brighton, and Dublin. For a house in London, Abe's studio conjured a rainbow-coloured spiral staircases and playground slides linking one story to the next. A Mayfair clothing shop, Emperor Moth, became a mirrored crystal cave in which automated mannequins slowly gyrate. Rogers even took on the staid Little Chef roadside eatery, giving every uniform and ceiling tile a playful new reason for existing. A former cabinet maker and sailor, Rogers earned his MA in design from the Royal College of Art, where he met Shona Kitchen, with whom he co-founded Kitchen Rogers Design, ARD, in 1997. Kitchen and Rogers projects included the Comme des Garçons store in Paris, the Alostura luxury department store in Kuwait City, and the Michel Guillon flagship store in London. Following extensive teaching at Leeds Metropolitan University, Parsons Institute of Design, New York, Strelka Institute for Media, Architecture and Design in Moscow, and the Eindhoven Design Academy, Netherlands, Abe was head of program for the Master's Interior Design course at the Royal College of Art from 2012 to 2015, which means from a teaching point of view, Abe really knows what he's talking about. One of the quotes I love most from Abe is the following. I'm losing my voice. When you are teaching students, if you ask them to design a table, they will surely design a table. If you ask them to design a surface to put things on, they are much more likely to come up with a different answer to that same question. I'd like to welcome Abe to the AA, and without further ado, hand over to him.
Thank you so much. And it's so great to be talking to the AA on this day, and of course with the long history of my dad, who was there so many years ago. who always had problems with getting his lines to meet up through his dyslexia and his neurodiverse way of seeing things. And maybe it was only really by getting my mum, a sociologist, to learn architecture that she could carry out so much of his study work. Anyway, that is a longer conversation. I think for me, dyslexia has been a really important tool. And I think it's important to say that I do not see it as a learning difficulty. I see it as a learning difference. And I think that the problem is that the whole educational system is geared to the 80% of the norms. And us 20% who are less normal, and no one is normal, and everyone sits on a spectrum somewhere, get kind of left behind, or we get left to find our own ways. I think what Claire was saying about the numbers is so interesting, but when it gets really scary, and you look at the Royal College or the AA, you were talking about 25%, I think if you start to include the full spectrum of kind of neurodiverse, I think it gets higher. But you look in a prison and it shoots up, to varying studies, but from 60 to 80% of inmates have some type of neurodiversity. So it really starts to show us that we can take, I think us who are from much more privileged backgrounds, it's very easy for us to discover art and design and even surgery or music or dance and be confident within it. But those who are less privileged and become more and more misunderstood as neurodiverse. And that is a real issue that maybe our community needs to somehow address. Anyway, I'm going to take you through 18 projects, which is probably too many projects to take you through in an hour. But I wanted to kind of describe the journey, which I think has been very important for me, and the importance of discovery and curiosity along the way. So maybe I will start. Let's see if I can start. Okay. So hopefully everyone can see. So this is our studio, as it is in this present state of the world, where we spend our lives designing spaces, and now we can't live in the spaces. We have to stay very remote. We have two studios. The main one is in London. We're about 20 people. And then we have 6 people in Melbourne working out of there. So I suppose one of the good things about the remote world is as two studios, we come closer together because there's less separation. It's only the time, not the physical outputs. So I think, for me, the key to design or life is inspiration. And it's finding inspiration everywhere. We often get criticized for our overuse of color, our overuse of saturated colors. And I always like to push back and say, actually, there's many more saturated colors in the very natural world. And you just need to go to a vegetable market to see the extraordinary deep colors that you discover, from the chilies to the bananas to the peaches and far beyond. But there's also great discoveries in places we can't get to so easily as the market. I find context is so important. And we go into the deep abyss, which is some 4 kilometers under the sea level, we start to find really balmy animals, or apparently balmy to us. So the deep sea anglerfish, who is the main creature, who has these parasites, the male parasites that inject sperm into her but have very little function, goes around with her little luring light, capturing animals and eating them. She can open her jaw twice the size. And she's red. The reason she is red is that by the time, as you pass through the sea, you lose different light waves. So by the time you get to the deep abyss, the only light waves that can penetrate the 4 kilometers is the red waves. So if you are red, you become completely transparent. So it's almost the reverse of the way that I would use red, is to be seen. Here they're using red to disappear, which I find quite interesting. Anyway, now once we're down under the sea, the octopus, who is so truly extraordinary, they have no bones. So no compressive structure, only tensile. Well, it's not really, it's only tensile when it stretches, I guess. But they use the sea to be able to float around. So they can redistribute their flesh to kind of move through any size things. And then they can also change colors to match into the environment that they live in. They're very, they're also very intelligent and generally quite fascinating. And for me, these are really interesting metaphors of design, these strange contexts that they create and these biological responses to their environments. So being very dyslexic, I was kicked out of many schools. I left school at 16 and became a cabinet maker, did my city and guilds on a quite junior level, made toilet seats for the rich and the famous for a few years. But as making, one became more and more involved in designing, because if you make, you have to design how it comes together. And I, of course, came from a very, very design-rich environment. So in 92, we were commissioned to create a bookcase. And maybe these were the first thing I ever really designed consciously. It's important to say that when I was at cabinet making college for a year, when they came to do the show at the end of the year, my partner, Claire Fisher, had three objects in the show and I had none, because everything I made was too experimental and never quite stood up and certainly didn't stand up straight. So there's always this state of curiosity of trying to question structure. So I think if you're making a bookshelf, you know, there's no one more brilliant than Garrett Ritvelt to start to look and to question these dynamic planes, so 90 degrees, so many layers, you kind of want to dive into it. But this had already been designed, so I had to design something quite different. So we created this, it was for an artist. It was this bookcase that expanded beyond its boundaries. It came out of the box. And us dyslexic are always accused or complimented for not staying inside boxes, for having no boundaries, for opening up and up and up and up. So in a way, it was quite a nice metaphor. But as well as having this ability to expand, it also had no cross structure. So it was based on these very small miters, and at a certain point it could very easily collapse. And I think a few did collapse along their way. So here we learn the importance of cross structure, I suppose. So this is the first exhibition they were in. At this point, this is the artist on the right, David McElwain, who commissioned it. And then I started making more of these to play with. This is in Liverpool back in like 1990. And the amazing thing about being Liverpool is we got hold of these huge spaces. And we could do stuff and we could talk to people and we could hang out with the art students and start to really play. And I think this is where I really started becoming a designer. So in Liverpool, we formed a group called a Head to Head. People like Jimmy Loazu, who's still around at Goldsmiths, Claire Fisher, who now has a restaurant called Galapati in Camberwell. Sandy Britton, who now teaches at Liverpool University. So, but this was where we were really fledgling youngsters. And I discovered an amazing book called The Hot House by Andrea Branzi, which really looks at Archizoom. And suddenly I saw this potential of design being so much more curious than the design that I knew. Why did a chair need to have a right angle? Why can't it be a piece of tightened rubber? Why can't a car expand and go beyond its breadth? So having fallen in love with the rubber, we made this pyramid, which sat in the center of this space. But again, being dyslexic and being very unacademic and having not studied maths, when I came to make a pyramid, I based everything on 90 degrees. So when the pyramid came together, it was formed a flat square, not a pyramid. So we had to very rapidly go back to our little workshop and cut things up and reform this pyramid into a more pyramid-like shape, having recalculated the angles, thanks to Jimmy Loazu. Claire Fisher, who was my life partner at the time and business partner, we would give each other briefs and we would play with materials. This is a sandwich of aluminium and rubber, and we called it the diving board. We had a studio which was subsidized by the local government. In return, we had to do 24-hour exhibitions. So this was just filling the windows full of spices and herbs, which we loved, both the texture, the color, and the notion of the smell. And then we got a friend of ours, Karen, to come and cover our building in clay and then paint kefir-like illustrations of wood across it. And this went on for 2 months, layer after layer, adding to it. So we had the clay, we had the red print, and then we brought in all these fluorescent colors. And the last part of the installation was washing it off and watching Duke Street become this fluorescent river of paint as it ran down. In 94, we started doing collaborations with my Italian cousins, which we called Zoom Ahead, in reference to Ahead Ahead and Archizoom, as these kind of these thinking. And we built, this is the Italians arriving in Liverpool, and we built this tower, we called a clock tower. And the idea there would be a ratchet and it would release a balloon on the hour. But of course, it never worked. It released the occasional balloon, but more than anything, we just had balloons above it. But what it did do is it pulled attention to the bottom of Duke Street, and it made this very vibrant, loud, this loud tower announcing design and Liverpool Design Initiative. So when we were playing with these collections, we started making these giant sausages made out of ripstop and found upholstery. I came really interested in found objects. So then in 95, we started making the monsters, which were just, we would buy funfair, we'd cut out bits of MDF and stuff them with found foam from other old sofas and cushions. And they became more and more eccentric and peculiar. This is Dada, Richard's mother, by the way. But many years later, I think in about 2002, Massimo Barozzi came to see us with his wife about curating us for a festival. And he saw these chairs, which by which point I thought were really irrelevant and eccentric. And he commissioned us to do maybe at the time as our most important piece, which was the monster for Edra. Now, it's true they only ever sold four of them, but to suddenly to be bent into the middle of Salon de Mobile, age 28, was such a thrill and so exciting. So in 96, we are moving on, how slow are we going? I went to the Royal College of Art with two O-levels, which are like two GCSEs today, and a funny box of things that I'd made. When I first entered, I did not get into it for lack of experience from Daniel Vile's perspective, a lack of knowledge of how to draw, how to put things to design rather than to make. However, I was on some shortlist. And when installing a reception desk at the Royal College of Art, the then head, Stephen Kiffin, came past me and said, "Hey, someone's dropped out. I think we have a place for you." Those 2 years for me were really instrumental in finding something I loved. And having always been a terrible student, I suddenly became, you know, the golden boy, working day and night, not partying. I'd done enough of that in the past. And I really fell in love with this idea of design based on absolutely reductive approaches. So looking at things like incredible sails, like space rockets, like sharks, like carbon fiber, and how reduced it is to the pure performance and the aesthetic that is produced from that kind of pure performance. The Royal College of Art, I met all these extraordinary people, and they really have influenced my career and my conversations. You know, Daniel Charney, ultimately to Mark Bullimore, who does special effects for James Bond, who is the second person at the RCA without a BA or A-levels. So it was a different time, and I think it'd be very hard for that to happen today. And I think that's something we need to really push for to change, because we must not have to all sit in these same modulated bubbles and have to fit through the same system. Talent needs to come out in different ways. Ian Johnson, Shona Kitchen, who became my business partner, Dominic Robson, who I still work with on a very regular basis, who is in CRD, Rachel Foster, who bicycled past me yesterday, etc. So I think we were doing a project for Leave Industry, and we were asked to design something about airplanes and airplane catering. And we looked at the way it all worked and the extreme amount of waste. And I thought the problem is not new cleaning products. The problem is the way that we consume food on the plane. So we proposed the pasty. For those who, you know, the original pasty was designed for the miners, and it was split into two, the savory and the sweet, all encased in one pastry. So taking that idea, we created this three-course pasty. In a first class, it'd be five courses. And it used to be wrapped up in a blanket and taken into the mines, and we did it in a kind of nano, kind of high-tech self-heating napkin that also contained nano salt, pepper, English mustard. Needed to be Lever Industries who were sponsoring the project were not impressed, but I found it quite interesting how we can design by removing the product rather than always adding to the process. So, as I said, having been a builder and a carpenter, I got really concerned by the notion of waste. And I started to follow skips around. It was this idea of going into people's houses and ripping out their kitchens and replacing them with something very, very similar that was already there. And started to think, well, how can we change this attitude to domestic architecture? So I wrote this, this is kind of my manifesto. We must liberate the lost voids, the domestic interior, and revolutionize the way the interior is conceived. We can fly to the moon, yet domestic environments remain unchanged. Wood, plaster, molding, self-mutating imitations of each other. We still live in buildings of bricks and mortar, using permanent structures in non-permanent situations. Any change means rip it up, throw it away. We have artificial intelligence, we have nanotechnology. Why can't we have intelligent interiors? I don't mean washing machines programmed by smartphones. I mean modular, the flexible, the impermanent, environments that reflect conditions that are forever changing. As needs for spaces should mutate, a new performance, a new solution. Throw away the rules, question the walls, and take nothing for granted. This was mainly written back in 97, but updated maybe with one or two lines along the way. So it's really about, you know, stopping throwing everything away and trying to find new ways of creating solutions. So I tried to develop an inflatable brick, which blew up along the way. But then we created a staircase in the bag. Again, trying to, you know, Buckminster Fuller, the notion of separation of compression and tension, which is something I'm sure is still being considered a lot at the AA, starting with a kind of staircase to the right, which had no stringers at all, just borrowing structure from the overstructured building of the Victorian architecture. And then I started with my examiner said, you should never try to create NASA solutions in the Royal College workshop. And I ignored this wise advice and did, and everything went wrong every time, trying to be overly precise in this less than precise. Well, I think the blame is with me, but the journey was so interesting that it didn't really matter. So I built a full-size staircase, and as soon as I walked up it, it broke, for example. But this is the notion of this kind of sculptural form, and you buy your staircase once and you take it with you from house to house. This was the idea of a table that lived in the ceiling as a light and only became a table when you needed it. So kind of trying to create these versatile spaces. I would use all these superheroes as characters for their models to understand how they use. And this was the final table, which again, when I put 1.5 tons of pressure into it, suddenly something slipped and it flew to the concrete and broke the morning of my degree show into 1,000 pieces. But luckily they were nice enough to let me through. So in leaving the Royal College in 97 with Shona, we had, actually, one more thing I would say about the Royal College, the hardest thing for me was to write this dissertation, 5,000 words. And I counted every single word and I forgot to put my glossary into it. Had I done that, I would have got to the 5,000 a little bit easier. But I think, you know, I can communicate quite easily, but this thing of getting all these words into order onto a piece of paper still today fills me with trauma. And it's only by being fortunate enough to now have a writing partner who I work with all the time to create content, my content, but she develops it into our language, that it becomes much, much easier. I love writing, but I don't like having to put words. I don't like writing words. I like writing with my mouth, I think, is what I'm trying to say. Okay, so in 97, Project 6 only, my gosh, we were commissioned, we had our first commission to design a shop. But the budget for the shop was £12,000. That's not £12,000 fees, that's £12,000 colossal budget. And that was on Portobello Road. It was a shop for very cool kids. I don't know how do you do cool kids? Anyway, it's a shop for cool kids selling skateboards, surf stuff. So we based it all around the half pipe. We created this tube straight down, coming adjacent off Portobello Road, this being the window straight through this half pipe. But having no money, we built it itself. We made this extraordinary structure, piece by piece, assembled in the space. There's Jimmy again, Shona, Ray, who's the most brilliant cabinet maker, who still makes all our furniture, Ian, and on. And so you had this fantastic perspective of this tunnel going into the space. And then we painted it all in yellow, and there was this brilliant moment. We went back to back with spray guns. And the whole street came and freaked out and said that we were polluting the streets. So we had to roll on the paint. But the problem with this shop is when we started to put the merchandise in it, it lost its beauty. And we realized that retail was not just about creating amazing spaces, but it's about creating a dialogue, a tension between what's being sold and the environment that it's selling. A good shop should feel beautiful to shop, but it should also encourage the retail to go. This is stating the blimmin' obvious, but I suppose to us it wasn't so at the time. I think the key to Shona and my studio, KRD, was that we both took secondary jobs, so we didn't have to rely upon the studio for financial success. So she was a researcher at the Royal College of Art. I was 0.6 in Leeds, 3D course. So we could really play with the projects. We got commissioned to do a series of interventions in Spectrum in 98. Spectrum is like the 100% design of today. And we wanted to make these objects come alive. So we were representing FSB door handles and Bisley filing cabinets. So we wanted to really look at what is a door handle? What does it do? What brings it alive? What's the performance between the hand and the space? We also wanted to animate the space. We wanted people to feel to be laughing inside the trade show rather than just creating information. So this is for FSB door handles. We're back under sea. We used the security alarm system and attached a sound to each door handle. So as you open the door handle, it projected the sound, and the sound then created a personality for the door handle. So it started, you know, these are beautiful sculptures designed to sit inside your hand. We want to bring more attention to them. We want to create a better dialogue between the user and the handle. And once you get people laughing in an environment like this, I think the half your job is done. You're really changing the way people are responding to design and to the show. They were not actors. But of course, we were never paid for these commissions. They were all done as acts of love, because design is such a privilege that you should do it for free. I mean, no one would ask an accountant to do your books for an act of love. But this happens to designers all the time, particularly in the beginning of their careers. And for the same show, we also did Bisley filing cabinets. And here we just added a motor, no computers, working with Mark Bullimore, who you met at the Royal College. We just had these little these motors and little locomotive throws that would just push them out. Each day, one would break, more or less. Someone would wedge it. But when we were designing this, Bisley wanted us to fill the drawers with seashells. And we said, why? You don't put seashells in your filing cabinets. You put files. We want to be, you know, we want to be strong and real to the project. We just want to make this automation. A number of people who wanted us then to make electric automated drawers for Bisley was also funny, but that really wasn't the point. The point was about looking at what the thing that the Bisley does well. It makes its drawers move beautifully. So we carried on developing this language of kinetics and immersive in installations. I think Helen Chadwick must have just done a show at the Serpentine, and we were fascinated by her chocolate cauldron. But I cannot tell you my belief in the importance of the interrelationship between art and design and inspiration. And art is so much freer than design. And for me, one of the hardest things about lockdown has been the denial of being able to go and see shows. I'm not just talking about shows at the Tape. I'm talking about shows at the Gaswork. I'm talking about shows in the Lyon Biennale. I'm talking about shows everywhere that we go and we travel, and how art gets to the base of community and tries to really transform its the dialogue and the conversation. And for me, that is so exciting. So, sorry, I got distracted. This is the responsive space. So it's a ceiling that moves around in response to you. It gets taller, it gets lower, it moves. It's really saying, why are rooms so static? Why can't we, you know, when you're watching a film, you want to cozy, why can't the ceiling come down low? When you wake up and you want this huge space, why can't your ceiling be higher? why can't we play with this dialogue and this response and see how people react to it? Again, the first time we engineered it, we made the cogs too big. They all live up here. And the speed it would travel was terrifying. It was quite scary anyway, but the first, when we got it wrong, it was, you know, so we had to be, luckily we were ahead of our schedule. We had to take them back to the Leeds workshop with amazing technicians in my university from Kelvin Grove in Glasgow and get them re-engineered and installed. And when I went down to take it down, back to Kelvin Grove 6 months later, the wire cables were down to their last thread. Now, it would not have fallen and squashed in on because we had loads of bungee for such an occasion, but it would have been quite embarrassing. And we were saved by the day. And I think, you know, what we were learning is great. Kinetics is fantastic. Immersive is amazing. But we need to find ways of engineering things so they stop breaking. We needed to, we were working on too large a scale to take these big risks. It is true, though, having taken this very safety approach, 3 years later in Q8, we had a mannequin in a three-story atrium get pulled off its electric cable and fly down, but luckily not damage anyone. Anyway, so in 2001, we were commissioned by Comte des Garçons and Ray Kawakubo to create a shop in Paris. We had no idea quite how fortunate we were, and often the beauty of youth is not knowing your discoveries. This is the extraordinary way, Ray. And she came to us, she wanted a shop with an alien wave entering it. She wanted no one really to know the shop was there and only people who were dedicated enough to come in to find it. So we spent months designing this shop, having these very intense conversations, suddenly in the center of the world of fashion. We designed her runways. And for us, the shop was always red. Red is such an amazing, powerful color. As we heard at the beginning, you know, red is the strongest wavelength, so we can enter into the deep abyss. And halfway through the process of designing the shop, Ray said, no, it can't be red, anything but red. And for 3 weeks, we argued and convinced her it should be red, or thought we convinced her. And she turned to us and she said, I'm very happy with red, but I wanted to see your response if I told you it couldn't be red. And I think today we might not be as convicted. Today we have too many projects and we go, sure, you don't want red, blue, green, whatever. But I think the beauty of youth, of this part, this moment when you're coming out of learning, is your absolute obsession and conviction. And you must really harness that. We must harness that. And sometimes I forget it and I have to go back to it. But also we must choose our battles. And I have lost many and won a few. So back to the... This is Rue de Faubourg, which is like Paris's Bond Street. And there's a tiny sign here that says Comte des Garçons. And you walk in and every window is blocked out with red panels. So the shop has no influence on the square until you get to here. You go left to the installation or right to the shop. If you come to the shop, you have to wait 2 seconds for the sliding doors to open before you enter. This was the model that we made. We did everything in red from right in the beginning. We always said it was diagrammatic, but we knew really it was for real. We worked with these amazing fiberglass makers who were normally making military simulators in Brighton. So they were really precise. I've always been really passionate about makers and how things, but maybe that's from my making background. So they kind of, we put the shop inside a shop, this alien wave that re-entered the store. This is Ray Kawakubo's husband, Adrian Joffe, helping us get the panels down the streets. It was also quite crazy to be unloading onto this amazing high street with all these different panels. This is the courtyard full of the panels. And this was a moment 3 weeks before we opened when the Paris building regs decided that we could only have 25% of our ceilings covered in fiberglass. They'd had our samples for 6 months. And this is, you know, the complications of high-speed design and fit-outs and slow-speed ministries and responses. Anyway, the owner of the company, who was amazing, he got sorite, he cut these massive panels. We've got different panels made up in aluminium, and we got through this issue. One of the parts of the shop we were given was this pavilion, 45 square meters. And Ray Kawakubo said, can you design us an installation that represents the brand? So we made these cubes that spent their time just shuffling along, spinning and shuffling. They were on a little program, but it looked quite random. And this is shown that, you know, you could sit on them and they would spin. If you dragged your foot, the clutch would drag. And for 4 years, they were there. And now, of course, they sell T-shirts. But I think that to have such an invaluable piece of retail space and give it over to a brand installation is such an interesting way of commercializing. The problem of getting this brief so early in your career is it makes everything else feel quite secondary in some ways. This is the tunnel. There are some clothes in the store, but again, very light. This is the one store that we've designed that has not changed in 20 years. It's still there, 98% it was when we opened it. I'm proud to say it was very well made, so it maintains itself very well. It was well detailed, but it also had an amazing client. And I really think that you cannot make a great project without a great client. And that collaboration between the client and the designer is so in imperative. And she was extraordinary. So in 2002, we started playing with the idea of the office space. And we were commissioned by a company called Eden to look at the future of the office. So we made two little installations. This is Palamenko's work I find very influential, who makes machines by definition should never work. And this is Playtime by Jacques Tati, which I find also deeply fascinating in his kind of surreal look at the dysfunctionalism of the contemporary office space in the 60s in Paris. So we felt people were working too hard, and this has never felt more relevant than now. So we designed this machine called Rogue Ambient Table with stealth paint and a rubbery tail. You select a cube and you place it, and it gives you what appears to be a random background sound. And that sound allows you to create a context of somewhere very different. It's important also to remember that this is long before the intelligent telephone existed. We had little squares that you could, one finger tap. Well, I only use one finger anyway, but you could slowly tap very basic messages in. So as a selection of many different soundtracks that take you into these different environments and give you these different personas of where you're working.
Hello. Hi. Yeah. Hi, yeah. It's a really bad time. I take a day off to help my little girl.
It goes on and on. There's a football stadium, there's a disco, a jungle, you know. But it's just the power of sound and narrative and telling tales. So for the same show, we also did Micro Office. The laptop had just been invented. I think this laptop here has, well, not just been, but it was relatively new. This has like 8 meg of RAM. You know, these are really crazy old machines. That isn't irrelevant to the story. But it was about this mobile office, but the office felt so solid. So we wanted to find a way to create a much more dynamic and lighter office that could move with you and the laptop.
Hey, Porter, would you tell me the time? How much longer will it be till we cross that Mason-Dixon line? At daylight, would you tell that engineer to slow it down? Or better still, just stop the train, cause I want to look around. Hey, Porter, what time did you say? How much longer will it be till I can see the light of day? When we hit Dixie, will you tell that engineer to ring his bell and ask everybody that ain't asleep to stand right up and yell?
I think in a way here, the video is almost more important than the product. But it was this idea of trying to find new ways to work. And now we don't even need the desk. You know, we have our telephone, we have our laptops, we can put them on a cafe table, and that's our office. And I find this evolution really interesting. that we need to spend more time standing up and less time sitting down. Maybe not me, because I have varicose veins, but I think everyone else does. So we got, we won the Tate Modern Public Concourses when Vicente was the director in 2006. We'd worked in a few museums, but the Tate at that point in time, to me, was really this this cathedral of art, which had such strong, powerful notions. And we, you know, great fans of Herzog to Muron, great fans of William Scott. We didn't want to be competing with the architecture, so we really became about placing objects in space to transform the space. The main part of the brief from Vicente was, if people are not consuming art or in the cafe consuming food, they should be learning about art. And at the time, there were these very nice postmen that would come in every lunch and play cards all afternoon in the public concourses, which felt quite poetic. But he wanted this change of environment. He wanted to make everything dedicated to art. Working with a brilliant team, Marina Wheeler, who did the Tate logo, Sarah Finelli, an amazing illustrator, both in the Royal College of Art 2 years before me, David Tangley, a typographer, we started to develop a language. So it was this idea of just placing things in the space. The cinema was not in their brief, but it seemed to make such sense to place a cinema over the steps. The steps become the cathedral steps, and then you can watch films about art. Then all these interactive desks, and the simple idea being that you could interact, or you could look over into the turbine hall. And then we had to create this timeline. And for us, the importance is, as art, is not science. So it's very hard to say. Yeah, you can say that the Dadaists started in 1916, but you cannot say when the Dadaists became the Surrealists. So trying to use a very loose way to describe the passage of time of art with this very generous hand-illustrated word of Sarah Fanelli. And then these screens that just gave you 10-year updates of what was, every 20 years we put a screen in which tells you what's happening in the world and how the art is responding to it. And we soon learn how many too many wars that we have. But this red was also very specific red. It had the kind of emotions of pink in it. And it took a really long time to get this to a level. We pitched with a car paint sample, which is very hard to replicate in fiberglass. And then again, halfway through, Nick Sirota wants it to be blue, and we had to have a long, and we also won this argument. But maybe all the arguments we lost, I don't have in the lecture. So just to say them, I don't want to be smug about the arguments that we win, but we do win some. And this is just a little film. This was over two floors. So the Tate, it was there for 8 years. These are kind of a series of interventions which are really about exploring art and sculpture and what goes inside it. This is an interactive game that teaches you about artists, and you can win. And the important thing is that you can win. So it really got the kids engaging. And you can look at each other's eyes and you learn about Dali, you learn about other bits and pieces. Why should the back of the cinema not become a sofa? And why should the stairs not become the seats? So it's all these kind of borrowed surfaces, borrowed ideas. And then they asked us to create a playground that would educate under fives what cubism was. And we said that is simply impossible. But maybe what we can do is give you a playground that gives you the experience of cubism. So when you come down the slide, it plays the violin to you. When you go into the bottle, it makes the sound of water, but not trickling water because that makes five-year-olds pee, but bubbling water, which is much more embracing and exciting. So it's all these objects that start to transform and change the space rather than architecture. In 2007, we were commissioned to do a shop for this extraordinary Russian called Katya Mishvili. And she took me to Moscow. Well, this isn't Moscow. Sorry, this is in Tuscany. This is the Tarot Gardens by Nikki Sanfal. For me, it's one of the most extraordinary spaces. And when artists really start to create architecture, we can learn so much. It's so much more pure. It is, everything is directly constructed. Every tile is placed by an artist, not a fabricator. And this is a very different interrelationship between it. But the light is so extraordinary with all these facets of mirrors reflecting like a cave. But we're in the belly of her body. And they took me to Moscow, to Patriotic Square, and they introduced me to Master and Margarita. And being dyslexic, I read very, very slowly. I think this book took me a year and a half to read, but I remember everything. And I suppose it's that trade-off. The, you know, slow cooking, slow knowledge, we learn things deeper, but they take more commitment to understand. And this extraordinary surrealist novel about giant cats smoking cigarettes and magicians removing all the clothes from people in a theatre and people painting themselves in blue so they can fly. So it became this very surreal journey, this shop. And the original shop was in Petrobras Square. And it was this idea of creating a multifaceted cave that we could sit inside the shop that could be fabricated outside and simply installed. I got so excited by the thickness of the walls in Moscow, like 800 colossal stone walls to keep out the cold. And then this idea of clothes, you know, when we wear clothes, we don't stay still, we move. And so clothes need to be shown in a moving, flexible way. I still really believe in using illustrations and watercolors rather than continuously being too obsessed with the computer. It's so important to get away. It's so important to create tactility. So the Moscow shop never happened, but we did one shop, and that was in Mount Street in London. And we were the first fashion shop ever to be on Mount Street. And it was in a listed, grade one listed space, but we didn't touch the walls. We just created this timber tent, all numbered, it comes together. And inside the tent was all these crazy mirrors. And so it created this kind of amplified space that goes on and on, like a never-ending cave with extraordinary light and these mannequins that are popping and moving around the space. So again, like with Comte de Garçon, it's kind of creating a shop inside a shop, a cave inside a space. Even the Tate has similar notions of using these objects rather than environments. Sorry, objects rather than architecture to guide people around. We don't need to wedge to the ceiling. We don't need to create isolation. We can allow spaces to breathe, or we can create these little caves that we plug inside. But it was extraordinary how the different stories that these mirrors started to tell. I'm fascinated by mirrors. I love playing with them still today. They appear in many of our designs. So I think this is the rainbow staircase for the same client as we saw before. I'll show it quite quickly. But again, the mirrored space we saw before came from the belly here. Her bedroom's in her breast. You enter through her belly button, and the kitchen is back here. But for me, there's so much freedom in this project. I find it so inspiring. I go back there time and time again, and it never stops amazing me. For me, Nikki Sanfel was a really powerful, important artist and an extraordinary influence. And her interrelationship with Tati is also quite remarkable. So Notting Hill Gate townhouse, quite constrained. We removed all the walls. We lit lighting from everywhere, even from the ceiling. And the only walls which we didn't remove, we'd put mirrors to bounce the light back into it. So the main thing was to create this staircase that leads you through the whole space. We had 52 steps, but we could not get 52 colors that we liked. So we ended up with 26 colors and doubling up the stairs, but it leads you to this giant space at the end with a skylight. And then, as I was saying, all the light bounces back. The mirrored wall contains the toilet, the steam shower, and the wardrobes and the fire. And then the floors are all commissioned by Richard Wood, the artist. But having walked slowly up the spiral staircase, you want to come back down in a hurry. So we have a little slide situation that brings you down. And then the yellow sofa levitates up, transforming the space. We spent more money on building regs, trying to get new little legislations passed to allow us to have moving platforms in living rooms than we did on the fabricating of the moving parts. Then you go back outside, this tropical garden, we're looking at the West Way and into the bed. And of course, in a place like this, you can't choose what direction the bed should live in. It can be looking outside the window, or we can swing around endlessly. And then this is just start to look at some of the details going through the space. The separation apart, keeping clear narrative of the new interventions and the and what's there already. Okay, I think we're moving on. We're a little bit running behind, so I'll try and speed up. So then I think we've been working on student accommodation for some 10 years now, and really looking at tiny spaces and seeing how we can use design to make these tiny spaces breathe and function much better. And the interesting thing is if everything has to work super hard. So we remove the corner of the bathroom so you get a better view out. We push the windows outside so you can extend the building a little bit. I also think this starts to give you a really interesting relationship with the architects, because we're mainly working on the interior, where the interior starts to influence the architecture and the architecture influences the interior. So we get this two-way conversation. We talk a lot about designing from the inside, designing around the program of the user. The little breakfast bar becomes a protector of the bed, the kitchen, desk, wardrobe. Now, with time, we started to make them bigger. They're more like, this was 13 square meters. Now we're working more on 16 square meters. Just have a bit more space to breathe. We didn't use a lot of color. The back wall becomes the sofa, so on the bed, but we used enough color to engage it. You know, these are all the risers. Then we'd put a little fiberglass panel in front of the risers. We have a light that bounces off the ceiling. You never want to have down lights in low spaces. It feels more repressive. And then big, you know, if you're going to be compressed in a small space, you need to have big spaces to decompress. Like the deep sea anglerfish, when you resurface, you need to decompress. Not that he or she, sorry, she resurfaces. This is Guildford, where we did the architecture and the interior. You know, the problem with contemporary architecture, I think, is we're so governed by the builder, by the planners, by the client's budget, that in the end we really run out of moves. But the important, for me, the real key is not in being a technocrat. The key is looking at the interface between the human and the architecture and how we can celebrate and make that really work. Communal spaces, menus on the walls. And this is the exterior designed by Stephen Marshall in Old Street. And you can see the windows, which are forced out by the brief that we have created. And this is a few of the, well, this is just opened in Ireland. These are all actually finished now, but we're working through. Okay, I'm gonna skip through this very quickly. So I have spent 3 years running the Royal College of Art course. I found it completely fascinating. I love preparing the lectures, bringing it up to date. But I found working as a dyslexic inside this super system, inside this corporation, very, very difficult. And after 3 years, I had to run back to my studios full time because I found it too limiting. But what I loved was the teaching. And the problem, I think, in today's education is teachers are not expected to teach enough and they're pulled too much into bureaucracy. And how can we free them of that bureaucracy? These are just a few of the projects that we would run with the students, but it was really about trying to make things one-to-one, trying to really question the environment, trying to learn how to make models, trying to conjure up ideas. For me, teaching is about opening up possibilities, not limiting possibilities, not telling people what they can't do or teaching them to draw, but showing them what else is out there, broadening their horizons, inspiring them through experiences. Engaging them about making, whether it's food, which I really adore, whether it is architecture, whether it's detail, it's bringing all these elements together, knowing the taste of your materials, the smell of your spaces, a kind of multi-sensual engaging philosophy of design. One of the projects we did was with the Bolton Tower, which is a project of ours, where we got them to go in and make temporary installations for Architecture Week, so one of which was an edible apartment. So working in a real space, but using food to completely transform it, the environment. These are all organic LED lights, which we made up having been given the technology from LG, which we then covered in candy floss. And I find this quite interesting, kind of low-tech, high-tech approach. I took the students to Iceland to do ice carving, which was super interesting and exciting. It's such a nice material to cut away. And it feels like magic because you can see how sharp it behaves, But of course, as soon as you take it anywhere slightly spit, not cold, it disappears into water. We would do edible dinner parties where they'd have to design different courses around different senses. Of course, an edible dinner party, every dinner party is edible, but these every course had a different sense of engagement. So really playing, really feeling, getting really deep, trying to question what an exhibition is. This is the first degrees show that we did in Battersea. Then I designed my dad's show at the Royal College, sorry, at the Royal Academy of Arts. The first thing was to try to get the influence of his building on the building itself. So hence the ventilation pipes, which obviously had no function, but a little bit of celebration, and you knew there was a state of change. It was really about creating a multi-geared approach. So we wanted to talk about not just architecture, but about ideas as well.
Thinking it is humanism, and there's a link to Italy.
About ideas, about influences. There is more to architecture than architecture. We said no, we minimized the photos. We had very few, we had no CGIs. It would be about drawings, about words, about models and films. But talking about the campaigning nature of Richard, talking about everything, the more global system, rather than focusing on the micro.
The whole humanistic philosophy under the Renaissance.
There were amazing reports from the AA for him, which I will dig out for the workshop we're doing next week, which were in the exhibition, I mean, sorry.
I was born in Florence. As it happens, I was born more overlooking Brunelleschi's wonderful dome. I was strongly influenced by my mother, who was a potter. Coming from Italy, with very modern views, she sheltered me from fear of the new, a shock of the new. I was greatly influenced by her view, and my father's too, of art as being part of life. Of all the greatest things that I enjoy, it's culture, and the study is a primary part of culture. Humanizing is a critical element about planning and architecture and creating buildings that encourage and spaces that encourage that humanism. I believe strongly in ethics, fairness, ethos. Public space is a physical manifestation of human values. Individuals have rights to public space. There should be a law that everybody can see at least a tree from their window. I was very much involved in my teens in political and social environment, and of course, campaigning is a critical part of this. I've always been more interested in periods of change, therefore I prefer early Renaissance, early Gothic, and early modern in a way, to overreach architecture of the later periods. I'm searching for an aesthetic which allows for change, the ability of buildings to respond, like a sunflower opening to the sun. Buildings have to open and absorb the sun, or buildings have to adapt. I have a very beautiful watch for my mother. It's very much inside out because it wears its machine on the outside. It's a very beautiful watch in terms of it's all colors, and I love color. You see the workings of it. So in a way, it encapsulates what I do.
So I think this pink room here was really the essence of my dad, and we wanted to smell of him, not in a literal way, of course, though we could have created a perfume based on his odors. And we played this film, which really describes his philosophy. And the exhibition, the shelf, kind of shows you everything that's behind the ideas, the collaborations, the references, the material. And then the tables arranged at different heights allow you to engage with models in different spaces. And then the very strong kind of campaigning statements. These are more from the but you know, these different statements, which are really coming from his heart. And then this is the kind of all the background information that runs on a different gear. And I found this really interesting, this multi-geared approach to exhibition design. So My longtime collaborator since the days of Liverpool has been Ernesto Bartolini. He's also my cousin and my best friend. And he joined the studio full-time in 2014. And he brings, you know, he brings with this very solid knowledge. He's a very rigorous architect. He's very real. He's very physical. He has to understand everything before starting a project. I, on the other hand, am very slippery and quite need tethering to the ground. And I see the project finished before I start it. Now, what I see is often what comes out at the end, but we have these very different approaches, this very different dialogue, these very different tensions. And I really think that allows the studio to grow in different ways. We are both very creative, but we're coming at it from above and from below, and in between it meets, pushing each other out of our comfort zone, which for me is so important. Okay, this is the ladder that likes the wall. I think ladders are such beautiful structures. It's so completely legible. You see every element, you understand the connection. So when I had to design a chair for Richard as part of a V&A project in I think 13, I created this ladder, which you could project yourself and live in a different context, no longer having to look people eye in eye. By adjusting your position in the room, you adjust your ideas. So there's a light, there's a little table for a glass of wine or for sketching, etc. Okay, final project. So, which is really the most important project we've ever done, which is Maggie's at the Royal Marsden. And we had, you know, we spent 7 years designing it. What a luxury it is. I really miss it, to be honest. You know, sometimes one's in a hurry to get projects, but when they're this vital. And for me, you know, having worked a lot in exhibitions and then in retail, I think working in medical, in caring environments is super interesting. And we've started to develop this idea, which is we're not the first people to develop, about the interior or design being the third carer. So what can the environment do to really support your needs? What can the environment do to help someone with neurodiversity feel more at home and more at peace? What can we do to play with these notions? So maybe the first most important thing is light. So let's fill the building with light coming in it from every direction. And maybe the next thing is to make it really porous. So we can always see out. We never feel hemmed in. There's always a way to go. We created a collection of interlocking spaces. So if you're feeling very cramped, you can go if you're feeling very introverted, you can go into a very small space and look out of a window. If you're feeling like company, you can go into the kitchen and share tea. If you need to run to the bathroom to cry, you're in a space which is really nurturing. This is really one of the philosophies of Maggie Kent, who founded Maggie's. And then in doing this, creating this architecture that nurtures people, we worked with Pete Ordoff, the amazing landscape gardener, who as many things as, and great plantsman, is behind the planting of the Highline. So the garden nurtures the building nurtures the people, the garden also nurtures the people get views of the garden, so it all becomes interconnected. We are in the middle of a car park. So we've got to create this kind of magical world in the middle of a car park, hidden away. So with these collection of interlocking chambers, takes you all the way through. So if we're saying we need light, we need porosity, we need different scale spaces, we need warmth, but we also need tactility. People who have had lots of chemotherapy, as many visitors to Maggie's have, do not want metal handles or metal cutlery because it feels so cold to their tactility. They want warmth. People who are feeling frustrated by the hospital, they need to feel they are in a space that's designed around their pleasure, that they are being considered. So everything needs to have a touch of the hand. So the building is surrounded in terracotta, dug out of the Tuscan hills, machined, glazed, and brought to Britain. Even the roof is glazed tiling. You know, as the towers of the hospitals build around it, we want it to be a beacon of excellence. We want the roof, the fifth facade, to be considered. Well, there's many more than five facades on this building, but you know what I mean. We want, you know, so we created this double height space. We have this luminous ribbon that wraps around it and nurtures it. we have this kind of, we know corners, you move from horizontal to vertical to horizontal through a large radius. We form it all around a big tree. You enter, you come into the building here, you can navigate around the back, you can lead yourself up. So you're very free to move in different ways. Bookshelves contain information. And then this is the little outhouse that goes on here. So you're greeted by a wooden door with a large handle that you open. Rather than having awful stickers on the windows to stop people walking into them, we got Sarah Finelli to draw little circles. And you can feel that hand touch, that nature. You can see right through the building, through these different holes along the way. So it never feels like a prison or a castle. It is a porous sieve. Always seeing out to the building in many different ways. It's a pity about the Neo-Georgian architecture next door. In fact, in planning, they said to us, we got a letter from the resident saying, could you not make the building more Georgian? And we said, no, because we're not in the Georgian times. Removing corners, the body is soft. The soft corners are so much nicer. Inserting timber shelves wherever necessary. Bringing colour to the bathrooms, that kind of sense of celebration. You know, creating this focus point in the centre, all around the kitchen worktop. I went to Tuscany to hand glaze these lights. So everything has this kind of notion of the hand. All the door handles are handmade by an artist. Each one is different. So as you interact with them in the hand, you're holding these little sculptures. Every bathroom has a skylight that allows light to pour into it. So they become these chapels, these spaces of escape. Everything thought about is really in opposition to the NHS, where we are working, but we have such restrictions. But what makes this project amazing is the clients. Laura and Marsha are so well informed. They don't carry egos. They want to create each centre the better than the last. They want to push and engage the architects. So as long as one is open to a conversation, or one is open to listening and curious, then you can find really amazing installations. And the only time things like these projects go wrong is when the architect has too much ego and wants to create some manifestation of their ego rather than listening and deconstructing every element of the brief. When a brief is as good as this, why would you deconstruct it? So we come full of shadow and movement as we play along. This is my little Lula, a little Jay. Sorry, Lula is my 19-year-old. But you can see always, you know, you stand here, you can see five windows to get out. And it's really important to see through the building. The story of the door handles and this tactility that goes on. But, you know, we chose every piece of furniture. We chose all the cutlery. We could make sure everything was warm. When we chose, everything is a constant conversation. So you can sit in these alcoves with light pouring upon your head, learning from Barragan and other such things. You can stay up here and you can see all these different routes out, having run your hands along the wooden handles. Then, you know, shelves that hold all these stories of books, of sculpture, of art, of play. The green space that flows out to the garden, the dark room where you sit and look long views out of the window. And then this, the outside, the courtyard, the building nestled into the architecture. Sitting so you know, you would not imagine you're surrounded by massive monolithic hospitals and car parks in every direction. And then this little outhouse, which is a very simple timber box, placed at an angle that splays, opens up, and you get this quite interesting dialogue of the different levels going on, but you can flow from inside to outside as the kind of thinking of the whole building demonstrates. You get this dialogue between in and out is really interesting. Phew. Thank you. And I'm sorry I've run over a little bit. I'm very happy to do a few questions, but I should be gone in 7 minutes, I guess.
Abe, thank you. That was such a remarkable journey through your work. I mean, I feel breathless, but I loved it.
I feel breathless.
Yeah. I'm sure you did too. Mm. We've got, if Tom agrees, we've got about 10 minutes for questions. So if people would like to raise their hand in the chat, or just raise their hand and we'll see you. Feel free to do that, and we'll take about 10 minutes for questions.
Oh, there's a hand, a black hand, I mean, a black screen, Michelle Collins.
Well, yeah. Is there any
hands? Yeah.
Michelle.
Hello. Hi. I wanted to ask the question about gesture, because I've been studying it for a while with regards also with objects and architecture and stairs. And I was thinking, I was looking into like the gestures of animals, but also like archetypal forms. So I was looking into Steiner, like he does the gesture of ah, where everyone opens up, or like, you know, hugs, different movements that. Yeah, and so I didn't realize how much of your work like lent into that, and I wanted to just see if you had any direction or comments, because I think there's a real dialogue, like say the boxes in Kabukubo, in Rays and the Red One, like there's these moments for a deeper dialogue, and I just really felt like what happens if architecture also started speaking to archetypal gestures or the vowels or to things that we all feel. I think we all feel innately as people similarly, and I wanted
and differently at the same time.
Yeah, and dynamics like yin and yang, like some people may feel internal, external, like you were saying, and just how
an
do we
internal person can feel external the next day. So I think I suppose my worry with all this is it can become too boxy and too fixed. So I think it's I think we can start to be too literal and say yellow is for energy and red is for depression and green is for, you know, I think it depends how we play with those, and those archetypes also can become too limiting. For us, we're really passionate about is trying to bring joy into the areas that we work in. And I know with Maggie's, when I go in, and it sounds smug to say, but I see people coming in with really fucking awful cancer and then laughing because of the state of being able to breathe out. I think tactility is really important because tactility engages your spirits. Sound is really important. And I think us designers don't spend enough time thinking about the effect that our environment has upon the sound. And if you want to create an environment around well-being, then it's really important to not create obnoxious sounds. We need to keep things very smooth and soft and simple. I think, you know, for me, I never design extractors when we do kitchen. Of course, for restaurants and for clients, sometimes they force it. But I really love the smell of the food cooking inside the house. I think it really, and so it's engaging all these different elements of the senses that are their own gestures. So I don't know if a gesture needs to be overly formal. We can examine body language, and I find that really interesting within a meeting, but I don't think we can stimulate that in design and in architecture. The architecture should be the vessel, which is a gesture in its own right to an extent. But if we're not careful, if we take gesture too far down the line, we can end up creating something which is a little bit faux 1990s postmodernism, which is also quite dangerous. So we need to keep pure to what the gesture is doing, what the function is allowing. That is an extension.
I was just wondering, I mean, how do you feel about encoding and artificial intelligence and virtual reality stuff? Is there anything, like any thoughts on that and how now, because I mean, walls and things in our could gesture in response to actions, and we've got sensors and we've got all of that layer. It almost doesn't seem like it needs it with the low-tech, just natural ways of doing things. But I just wondered if you did have an approach, what would it be?
I love going to see interactive installations. I love art in its many... but as I get older, I find myself more and more interested in humble materials. I think had you asked me that question 20 years ago, I would have been all for walls of light that change. When I go into a space, I want a space that is absorbent. I don't want more noise. You know, we spend our days in virtual reality sitting on Zoom. I want to be able to touch things and feel things and smell things. So I feel, you know, a coldness to the overuse of technology within the domestic interior at this point in time. But that may well change. I think some people can do brilliant things with it. We're just designing a show at 180 The Strand of 11 amazing digital installations. you know, and I love going to see Marshmallow Laser Priest and putting on those crazy screens, but it's kind of a moment of entertainment. I don't really want to make permanent installations in my, I designed a bathroom for a client a few years ago, and I was really obsessed. The original idea was to project this onto the glass wall of the bathroom, this video installation, and she really pushed away from it. And I'm so pleased that we did. And I think it's so much more interesting project because it allows you to have your own reflections rather than someone else's reflections.
Abe, on that note, we might need to wrap up today. And keep our reflections. I'm sorry that we don't have time for more questions, but if we could keep our questions and reflections for next week, Abe's giving a practical workshop where he very much encourages people to bring work to talk about the designs, bring your work to discuss with him for the 2-hour workshop next week. It'll be advertised in AA Weekly this week weekend, so we can sign up for it. It'll be 10:45 to 12:45 next Wednesday, which only leaves me to thank Abe so much for, I mean, this was just an exhilarating talk. I'm sure we all appreciated it so much, his time. Thank you so much, everybody. Please join me in thanking Abe and very much look forward to seeing him next week. Thank you, Abe.